Ram, thank you for your kind words. Thanks for the introduction to this topic, especially about the lack of penetration of internet in this country. Professor Swaminathan, Mrs. Swaminathan, and colleagues from the Swaminathan Foundation and other organizations. I see the former Vice Chancellor of Gandhigram Rural Institute here, Mr. Voza. He was also, I remember, the Election Commissioner, Chief Electoral Officer of the state. I used to vote him in when you were still the officer, sir. Thank you. It's a very great opportunity to be speaking to you here, especially when there are many former colleagues. I'm going to speak about evolution of this Swaminathan paradigm of ICT for sustainable development. People may wonder what Swaminathan paradigm in this sense is. That's what I'm going to talk to you about. I currently work for the Commonwealth of Learning. Some of you would be familiar with it. I'm currently based in Vancouver in Canada. The context. This is the context. You know, very soon, just 10 days from now, there's going to be a very important intergovernmental meeting where heads of governments, at least some heads of governments, a lot of senior ministers, senior officials will get together to formulate the post-2015 development agenda. As you all know, in the year 2000, the governments came together under the aegis of the United Nations and agreed to Millennium Development Goals, MDGs as we used to call them. And the Millennium the year has run out. I mean, as 2015 comes to a close, from January 2016, governments want to commit to a broad program of a global understanding of development. And they will formulate a number of projects, initiatives, and programs in their own respective countries, which would address fulfilling the commitments that governments make in this particular event. So it's a very, very important event. So that's my context. Also, the context is that back in 1992, there was the Rio meeting, the famous conference. And I remember that Professor Swaminathan was very actively involved in it on behalf of both Government of India as well as in supporting the non-governmental action in relation to environment and development. And that also compounded with the prior definition of sustainable development from the Brundtland Commission in 1989. And eventually, they all played a very important role in international organizations in promoting different programs related to sustainable development. However, something went wrong or right, I don't know, that may be under pressure from some of the important countries. The word sustainable got dropped from many international organizations. For example, World Bank, which had an environmentally sustainable development department, more or less abolished that whole program, and the vice president who was holding that charge had to look for a job elsewhere. And it's also happened same way in FAO, which removed the word sustainable from agriculture. And instead they started calling it conservation agriculture because something did not strike the imagination of the influential policymakers anymore. But it's coming back. That's why I said there is a cycle of growth and bust even for terms like sustainable development. That term went through a growth phase in the 90s, busted in the first decade. Now it seems to be coming back with this new meeting. But let's look at this diagram. You know where this is from. Those of you who are familiar with it should be able to say which year it is. It is from the annual report of the M.S. Swaminathan Research Foundation, 1993. And if you see this diagram, which is quoted by the chairman in his introduction, what this diagram points us is that the top 20% of the global population was receiving a disproportionately high share of income, 82.7%. And as we went down, the income drastically declined, and at the lowest level, it was less than 2%. Now, this was highlighted in the UNDP's Human Development Report, which started to come out since that time. And the same report also pointed out that a lot of growth that occurred in the economy globally was not accompanied by growth in jobs. Instead, it was growth in monetary terms. But it also, Professor Swaminathan pointed out that it was contributing to this huge inequality. I mean, wealth was being generated, but wealth was not being generated in a way that benefited all human beings. Some human beings were getting greater advantages of that accumulation of wealth. Now, this was a recurring theme in the foundation. It also appeared again in the next annual report. Professor discussed it again. I continue to call him professor even to this minute. And again, they point out that the proportion was nowhere declining. I mean, it was continuing to remain the same. And now they openly point out that the poorest fifth, which would include very, very large number of people in this country and in fact in this entire region, South Asian region, they were receiving less than 1.4% of the world income. Similarly, if you look at a more concrete measure of wealth in terms of GNP, gross national product, you again find that world trade was disproportionately favoring the top 20%. And domestic savings were disproportionately higher with the 85.5%, etc. Now, much against my own grain of preparing slides, I've just flooded this with a lot of words. And these are important words. I've highlighted some, if you can see. Jobless growth is a phrase. And the other phrases that should be looked at are diversified and sustainable opportunities. And then appropriate blend of traditional and frontier technologies. Now, all these are important phrases. And these were written about by Professor Swaminathan in 1993. You'll find that as I conclude this lecture, you'll find that the summit that's about to start is discussing some of this precisely. Now, instead of merely guessing about, they're actually making them goals. That's a very big difference. If you look at the next statement, while discussing the program of the Swaminathan Foundation and the Center for Research on Sustainable Agriculture and Rural Development, Professor also promoted the idea of a shift from traditional approach. Instead of merely creating jobs, Professor said that we should be talking about skilled employment, becoming the engine of economic growth. Now, we all know that if there is one thing that Dr. Barack Obama, President of the United States, or the President of Sri Lanka, or the President of Grenada, which is a very small country, if there is one point they all agree on, is the importance of generating skilled jobs. And that income should come through skilled jobs. Everyone in the world, whether they represent a richer country or among the poorest countries, they all agree that skilled jobs should be the engine of economic growth. So that is also something the professor highlighted almost 25 years back. And that is again being taken up in the sustainable development paradigm today. And I should not fail to quote the last few words here. Without such a shift, the phenomenon of jobless growth will result in the further marginalization of the poor, the degradation of the environment, sense of despair among the educated youth, and ethnic and socio-political strife. We all know that today the world is facing an unprecedented refugee crisis since the time that we in India faced a refugee crisis from East Pakistan-Bangladesh border. And since that time, this is the biggest refugee crisis. And you also know that there is a sense of despair among educated youth. In fact, people who have analyzed terrorism often point out that a lot of terror action does come from that class of people, educated youth that have had no opportunities. So the professor has been quite visionary in outlining many of these ideas, and which went through their growth cycle for a while globally and busted, and now they seem to be coming back. Now, he was writing all this at a time when it was the era of the PCs, that was the information revolution. The year that this foundation was founded, in 1989, was also the year Tim Berners-Lee invented the World Wide Web, so to speak, 1989. In fact, last year was the time there were big celebrations of the 25th year of the World Wide Web, which was also the year that the foundation celebrated its 25th year. And as these words were composed, the words that I just showed you were being composed, the world, the Western world, the OECD countries were experiencing this great revolution, which is represented by this PC. Now, some of us here who are less than 25 might not even figure out what some of these parts are. Like, for example, how many of you have seen or used a 5 1/4 inch floppy in recent times? And I don't think many children today don't even know what it is, right? And that is the kind of pace at which things have changed in the last about 25 years. And as these PCs were evolving, Scientific American brought out a special issue. This issue now costs several hundred dollars to buy an original, and we used to have a copy here in the foundation. This special issue is very important because we see, if you can read the names of the authors, you find Michael Detussos, who was director of the Laboratory of Computer Science then at MIT, who's no more, and Nicholas Negroponte, who created the Media Lab and is under a bit of a cloud today for his One Child, One Computer program. And then Senator Al Gore, you know, Senator Al Gore eventually contested for the presidency of the United States and won the Nobel Prize. And you have many Mitch Kapper, I mean, whose invention, the spreadsheet, is with us to this minute. They all, some of the finest thinkers and technologists of the times, wrote in this issue. They brought it together. And they all pointed out that the future of this entire enterprise is going to be seen in the combination of computing and communication sciences and technologies. Until then, these two were totally apart, but they were pointing out that they were coming together. Today, we don't even understand. We simply take it for granted. You pull out a smartphone, which is actually a very advanced computer, more powerful than the PC that I showed you, and it instantly connects to a data network or to a voice network. You know, these have come together in ways that we could not imagine, but these visionaries were able to imagine. So while this was taking place, the talk was that of an information superhighway. As you all know, post-Second World War, the then President of the United States, Dwight Eisenhower, created the practice of interstate highways, which allowed free movement of goods and people, far easier movement of people and goods from one coast of the United States to the other coast. And that was considered to be a great, big, successful infrastructure building project. To this day, it still held so. And that's why they often use the metaphor of a highway, and they called it a superhighway. The information superhighway was already seen to be helping only the well-to-do. We were talking about the top 20. It was already seen only helping them. It has no room for the poor. These are words from Professor. And this is one reason why the MSSRF has placed considerable emphasis on taking the benefits of modern information technology to the rural poor. Our friends, this is the beginning of the Swaminathan paradigm for ICT in sustainable development. Because here is a direct link between the top 20, the bottom 20, and the people who are taking advantage. The top 20 should also ensure that the bottom 20 were getting the advantages, and information technology could be an opportunity. That was his vision. I'm going to give you some figures from one of the human development reports. In my humble opinion, it's the best ever report that this HDR series ever prepared. The chief editor was Richard Jolly, who visited this foundation, I remember, in 1999. And this, for the first time, the global community spoke of the era of 1991, etc. They took IT and communication seriously. They started issuing data and analysis based on figures relating to this sector. And what did they show? If you see here this teledensity figure, you find, you know what teledensity is. It's telephone lines for 100 people. And you would find that China was below 10 at that time. And India does not even figure, because India was less than 2. In fact, it was less than 1 at the time if you looked at India as a whole. And India could be in the class with Haiti, Kenya, Sierra Leone, Tanzania, Uganda, Afghanistan. India was not very far from this class. This was the figure. And that was how, and this is in 1997 data. This is based on that. This formal data submitted by Government of India to ITU. And so this divide was already clear. If you see United States and Sweden, way above 60. And most of us, way below 10. In fact, way below 5, way close to 1. So this divide was already very, very clear. Going further, this also talks of internet users. The chairman of this session, Mr. Ram, very kindly referred to this internet penetration. Even then, the divide was very, very severe. United States had not reached larger than 50% penetration. It was still below just about a quarter of the population. But in South Asia, look at South Asia figure, if you can see, it's 0.04. That was the penetration. South Asia, by and large, in internationally means it's India. I mean, because our population is so large that other countries really come under that. And you will find that the Arab states were 0.2, which were much richer compared to this part of the region and this country. And you would also look at internet users as percentage of national population. Only small countries like Iceland, less than 2 million population. Sweden again has a small population. Finland, small country. Among the big countries, United States was very high. Canada was, again, a medium-sized country. Singapore, small. They all had very high penetration. But you would not find India anywhere in this list. So the divide was very stark, and the divide was very, very clear. At that point in time, or well before the United Nations started taking note of this data, at least six years before that, Professor convened a dialogue of international experts and came up with a series of ideas, which is expressed in this diagram. that this diagram shows that for the first time rural families were discussed when IT was discussed. In so much divide when people even in urban areas could not connect to internet, professor was already talking about rural areas connecting to that. And he pointed out that there are content aggregators, providers, such as the universities, remote sensing centers, etc. They are great content providers, but they cannot directly link to the rural families for various reasons. So you need value adders. So this is quite different from the broadcast model where the frontline expert could connect to the ordinary folks. In other words, the best people in photography or subject matter expertise could connect via the Discovery Channel or the National Geographic or the PBS, the Public Broadcasting Service frontline in US. They could directly talk to a worker in a factory or to a farmer or to a peasant. That's the broadcast model never understood the value addition part. The biggest change that professor proposed was that you do need value adders. So that, in my view, was a fundamental breakthrough. That's the Village Knowledge Center continues to be based on that. But my humble submission was that the international community at that time was not prepared. What I call the Swaminathan principles for ICT for development should be that the information should be demand-driven, because people otherwise willing to sell whatever content they had, whether people needed it or not. I mean, that was one such tendency. The other is all generic information should be converted to locally specific and actionable information. Now, we know that this is still a tall order. I have met a number of senior police officials who deal with terrorism, and they say that the name of the game is actionable information, not generic information. They often get notices in many countries saying that something can happen. They say they can't act on. The same way a farmer cannot act on extremely generic information. So the professor gave a prescription that unless it's converted to locally actionable information, like weather prediction should be specific to that village or at least to a cluster of villages, not to a whole region. So these two principles were also very critical to that diagram. However, it was early in the 90s and the euphoria was enormous and people were very, very keen on buying expensive PCs. I remember in 1993, a personal computer could cost 1 lakh rupees. And that was the time when most junior professionals, like a lecturer in a university, was earning less than 60,000 rupees a year. So the proportion, as you can see, the personal computer was very, very, internet was not even available, of course, in India at that time. So people were looking at spending more on acquisition of devices rather than on creating new programs to allow people to access information. That was the state with the global development community. In the meanwhile, the professor pressed ahead with creating the mangrove ecosystems information service. And in the meanwhile, the World Trade Organization came into existence in 1994. It was very unique in the sense that the people who promoted WTO claimed that it was outside the United Nations ambit and family, and it was an organization in itself. And they came out with this rather dangerous concept of and practice of TRIPS, which continues to affect many nations to this minute, the trade-related intellectual property systems, which still affects many, many countries. And therefore, one of the ideas that professor had was if we had the right information in this very hall, I remember, the former Chief Justice of India, Honorable R.S. Pathak, came here and pointed out that in India, when trade acts come in like this, they will always dismantle traditional arrangements, and that modern judicial systems based on Anglo-Saxon jurisprudence do not recognize community as a source of knowledge, that only individuals are recognized as sources of knowledge, or it could be companies. And therefore, professor came up with the idea of a farmer rights information service where you do identify a village, a folk knowledge with a particular individual. So all these databases were created. They were called multimedia databases. Then you would call them more like Wikipedia pages today. They were graphic. They included good graphics, some videos, as well as excellent descriptions of what the locality was and what the knowledge was and who was the holder of that knowledge. While all this was going on, somebody took interest, Canada took interest, the International Development Research Center came forward to fund the concept, promote the concept of Information Village, and it was built on the hub and spokes model, which is a direct evolution from the ideas that professor traced out in 1992, that generic information must be converted to local specific one, national regional resources must be made into local resources, again something that the broadcast media would not do. The other concept of value addition resulted in a hub, because you know, you need, as I will show in the next diagram, you would need a place where this value addition takes place, and from there the redistribution occurs. I mean, in material terms, even today, for example, petroleum distribution goes on that way. All petrol products are distributed from a local center into the gas stations or petrol bunks, as we call them. I mean, those concepts, the hub and spokes models, exist in distribution of physical goods. I'm sure Mr. Oza, eminent civil servant, would agree that civil supplies works along these lines of storing in local godowns and distributing from them. But somehow the broadcast model, which the IT community was adopting then, was not following that. So here is a very, I mean, it's also an archival diagram. This diagram, based on analysis done in Pondicherry, where the foundation's projects were taking place at that time, shows that a lot of information requirement is actually occurring between the locality and the supra-locality, which reinforces the view that you need value adders at the supra-locality level, if not in the same village, at least inside the cluster of the village or among the clusters of villages, but not in a far-out town, not even like a district headquarters, certainly not like the state headquarters. And a lot of this information was coming from companies, etc., and it was not reaching the people directly. It was always operating through certain kind of intermediates, like the input supplier was playing a big role, continues to play a big role in advising farmers, just as I know many pharmacists play a big role in treating people. I mean, I've still see people walking up to a pharmacist and say, I have a headache, can you give me a tablet? I mean, they don't want to go to the doctor. The same way the input suppliers have played a critical role in advising farmers on what input to apply at what time. And that has led to disasters in many cases too, right? And therefore, this value addition was fundamentally necessary. But this was not an easy task. I mean, you know, technologically very challenging and extremely challenging, in fact. The capacity was missing both at the level among technologists. Like the big institutions in India at the time would not look at it. I mean, they thought that, whoa, I mean, what kind of a stuff are you talking about? So they would not take interest in it. Companies would not take interest in it because they were interested in only selling goods. And internet providers said that it's all in Madras. I mean, it was still called Madras at that time. You can go to Madras. Pondicherry did not have internet bulk of the time. But the great presidents came from, I mean, for example, the Wheat Revolution. This is chronicled in the Wheat Revolution Dialogue, which was published by the foundation with Macmillan. And where I've seen this figure, this could be a slightly off figure, but IARI, the Indian Agricultural Research Institute, in 1964, when the hybrid wheat demonstration program started, had only 4 hectares in 1964. They eventually closed the program in 1970, by which time it had spread to 4 million hectares. Now, this is in a country where, you know, communication was difficult and roads were not available, people-to-people contact was limited to localities, and practically all the scientists working on hybrid wheats were in just one laboratory, that was Professor Swaminathan's laboratory in Delhi. So civil servants such as Mr. Oza here is, they played a big role in working with the scientists and taking this forward. It's a very big challenge, but it was met beautifully and effectively, and we all are enjoying the benefits of this to this day. There's another one. This is Tumba Research Station, the rocket station, 1963, and you can see one man, you know, carrying a rocket pot on a bicycle. I mean, you know, this was how it used to be. And 1981, this news item I found, they were loading Apple satellite on a bullock cart and taking it to the launch pad. This was taking place. And they were all transformed. Today, day before I saw in a newspaper, the most sophisticated vehicle that Israel has designed to carry a satellite from one place to another. It's really sophisticated. It shows class. It shows enormous technological savviness and prowess. But there were people, such as the late President Dr. Abdul Kalam was responsible. They all helped overcome many of the, you could take a satellite in a bullock cart, so what, the fact is a satellite flies and it connects you. So this kind of, we had people with that kind of spirit were available and professor was guiding us, and therefore we went for low cost, low tech connectivity solutions. There were several, but I knew one, I knew a couple. And there were people who were saying that we could sell you much better technology. Well, I mean, our aim was not to buy the best technology. Our aim was to get the job done. And many of these were put together innovatively such that the foundation received global awards. I mean, because they were put together in a very, very innovative way, and people were able to say that, yes, I'm indeed able to derive certain new benefits. Power was another big challenge. Solar power, you know, the foundation has been a pioneer in this area. In 1993, the entire informatics center here was powered by, since that time, it was at least then powered by solar panels. Very expensive then. Today, thanks to Chinese progress in manufacturing, the solar panels, there's a glut and the price is unimaginably low now compared to 1993. They were adapted to support village information centers in 1999. So as this was going on, two questions arose. One was about sustainability. You know, number of us who were involved in the village information program were repeatedly asked by people saying that this project is not sustainable, it's donor-driven. I mean, government officials always said it's donor-driven. And private sector always said that the technology is unviable. And therefore, from either side, there were criticisms. And these criticisms were insidious then. But I used to ask, I mean, some of them, when they asked me, I said, have you ever asked this question to a company like Microsoft, are they sustainable? And so they would never ask that question. But I was proved right. 2008, Lehman Brothers vanished without a trace in 1 week's time, taking with them $665 billion. So were they sustainable? And the village centers that were started by the foundation in 1997-98 are still running to this day. And Lehman Brothers has become history in the meanwhile. So did many other great financial organizations. I called it insidious because the notion they were advancing, it was founded on the writings of Professor Prahlad, Coimbatore Prahlad, and C.K. Prahlad, and later by Jeffrey Sachs. Many of them were advocating the idea that there could be a fortune made out of these poor people. Go rip them off. That's what I interpreted it to be. And that's why I called it insidious. Now it's ridiculous. No one even talks about these things. Scalability. They said, if you guys do this kind of content work, Mike Best, who was then at MIT, now at Stephens Institute of Technology, and continues to edit a very, very, very prestigious journal. Mike Best said that what you guys do here is content research. At this stage, you'll never scale. You'll be limited to these 5 or 6 villages. It's not so. Today, I mean, you know, Nancy would be able to give out figures. The scale has definitely changed. But I would say there are complementary examples too. I can give, just taking a small deviation, I'll give one example. You know, you could scale with highly localized information, actionable information, even making it very, very actionable, but you can still scale. For example, we all know that drought is a serious problem. India's just last few weeks seems to be facing a drought. Internationally, they know that large part of South Asia is facing this drought conditions. And drought management, we all know, is very local. I mean, it's not quite as global or regional or national as it's made out to be. Although the information often occurs at the level where only a region could understand. But combination of local truthing can now be put together with satellite imageries and GIS tools to scale up. And you can still make them highly actionable. I'll give one example this from Mehboob Nagar district in Telangana state this country. This is primarily done by Sridhar, who's a mid-level professional at Infosys Corporation and a doctoral scholar at IIT Bombay. And these color-coded maps were evolved per village by village. So before, when the season began, the scholars approached villages with these maps and showed them that you could be highly vulnerable in this scenario. As soon as the IMD gave the prediction, like here it says annual rainfall 550 min. That's the prediction that IMD gave for the region. And village by village, the scholars would approach them and say, your village is highly vulnerable. If you're in red, you're really vulnerable. Even drinking water would be in short supply. So identify the crops that suit dry conditions more, or start watering your animals in an appropriate way, etc. They would give this kind of an advice. Now, this could not scale, that's what they said, but if you find, you could use the satellite imagery today, which are very advanced, and a number of other GIS techniques now, they've been able to cover at one go 297 villages. So season after season, you can work like this. You can practically cover every village in India as soon as the IMD comes up with its prediction. You can cover every village in India, every river basin in India, in terms of how vulnerable that every village there would be to drought. So these are all content, you know, if you do the right kind of content approach, scalability is definitely possible. That's what we want to show, and the professor always envisioned that it should be so. Then, I'm my deviation is, or I'm back to the main course of this lecture. Bruce Alberts, who was at the time the president of United States National Academy, and probably the exceptional president in the sense that he often put the human being in academies' discussions and considerations, often center. At this time, this was the time when the academy has, in my very humble opinion, has become kind of the life sciences group is dominated by company interests, in my understanding. But Bruce Alberts, although a life scientist, was way above that, and he visited the villages here, and he was a great admirer of Professor Swaminathan. He is a great admirer. And he came out with an idea. This is the lecture by the president of the National Academy of Sciences in the year 1999, which is de facto the closing address of the century. And in the closing address of the century, he outlined this really big idea based on what he saw in Foundation's work. And he said that a global electronic network that connects scientists to people at all levels. And he said this network would allow them easy access to scientific and technical knowledge, and they should solve local problems. This technical knowledge was not meant for keeping in the brain. It was meant for solving local problems and enhance the quality of life and communicate their own insights and needs back to scientists. So he envisioned as a fully interactive two-way network. This is a kind of vision that Professor outlined when he wrote about the information superhighway going to the poor back in 1992-93. So now, this has taken a much bigger shape in the form of the National Virtual Academy for Rural Prosperity, and it has expanded in considerable extent. The number of people approached by the reached by the academy, the number of people connected to the academy and to each other through the academy is stupendous. I won't go into that because these details are available through the foundation's website and through a large number of publications, but you can see how an idea seeded in 1992 by 2004 had become acquired a major national currency. And to this day, I believe with my limited knowledge, I would say India remains unique in this way because India is one country that showed that IT can be applied direct to rural circumstances without having to invoke the slightly unsound principle of private-public sector partnerships. You know, you could do it directly using public. I mean, as public, you could do that. Public-people partnership, you could do that. But let's also take a small diversion. You know, as these ideas were advancing, the era of mobility has arrived. The era of mobility has arrived in a way that we could not even anticipate. Most technologies completely failed, and the results are there for everyone to see. I mean, there were people, when the Information Village program was being set up, they were saying that, you know, private sector can do this much better, and we know how to do this. They set up founded companies, and 10 years later, the companies have gone bankrupt, whereas the people who floated them have found other useful occupations. They are members of Senate and this and that, etc. So the era of mobility has arrived, and I think there's probably one thing missing here. The era of mobility, as it arrives, what we also note is that in the area of virtual or online learning, you find this has also come of age. That's one major development that was taking place completely outside the area of IT for rural development. And two key developments I thought I should highlight. One is the rise of open educational resources. You know, I mentioned TRIPS, the intellectual property systems that link to trade. And you know that textbook is a very big business. It does not affect, that business does not affect our students the way it affects students in North America, both US and Canada. It's a very, very big thing. And the intellectual property systems related to educational resources are very, very demanding and very powerful. They demand close adherence. But there has been a breakthrough. That's the open educational resource. The other is the massive open online course. Now, open educational resources, I'm sure many of you have heard of them and many of you have even used them. I'm giving just one example from a Commonwealth country, United Kingdom. The Open Learn, which is managed by the Open University, has, as you would see later, hundreds and hundreds of extraordinarily good quality resources available for free. There are so many things available for free on the web, but you know that you can't use them. They're mostly meant for browsing. You cannot use them in your class. You cannot mix them in your own books. Whereas the open educational resource, which is today a movement which promotes the idea of public quality goods from quality teaching, was originally launched at MIT back in 2000, and the OCW, as they called it, led to the formulation of this concept called open educational resources by UNESCO in 2002. And most important part of the open educational resources is its open licensing. We all know, if you see a nice image, a bird which you want to use in your slide, see it on the web, you should not do that, because it's possible that the person who put it there has only allowed you the freedom of browsing and viewing, not the freedom of reusing. And whereas open educational resources based on the idea of reusability, that you should attribute this to, provided you give some kind of attribution to the source, share it alike. I mean, the rest are conditions. I mean, you should share it alike, some people could say. Like Wikipedia requests that you give attribution and share it alike. But there are ones sometimes put out by some universities say you cannot use it for commercial purposes, etc. So there are multiple ways of open licensing, but the critical part is the open licensing. In other words, it's my intellectual property, but I'm giving it to the public for free reuse. It's a major advancement. It came from the university system. And in UNESCO 2007 held a big meeting, and then a big conference was organized by the Commonwealth of Learning and UNESCO, called the World Warrior Congress in 2012, which led to many countries broadly adopting the OER policies. For example, I will later tell you, the Ministry of HRD could not send a representative, but the academics in India went ahead and recommended use of open licensing for some of their products. And today, in the Western world, governments are not funding open educational resources because they're split between commercial publishing, which contributes to election campaigns, and the universities, which demand that they have the freedom to make certain things available for free. Hewlett Foundation is one of the few to be putting millions of dollars into that. But countries like India are doing it with public money. Now, the Paris Declaration of OER focused on all these four aspects, advocacy, capacity, mostly, because you need to help people understand that this is highly doable, and you should also help build their capacity. So this has, as I said, led to 55 countries moving ahead in this direction. And who are the big players? United States, of course, is a very big player. You have MIT Connections, which is a multi-university one. Merlot, I mean, from California, because they like that wine. And China is, again, a major player. It's called China National Top Level Courses. Because of the bias that I see in the Anglo-Saxon world, and sometimes even in the European world, which is not Anglo-Saxon, China's contributions in this are not being given adequate recognition. The United Kingdom is a major player. India is a major player. And Nigeria too. Now, when you look at OER in the Commonwealth, in 1 minute, I'll just show less than a minute, you will find that India ranks alongside United Kingdom. And in fact, this is 2014. I would say today India is probably even bigger than United Kingdom. The quantum of contribution they make through open educational resources. And if you look at the big publishers across the Commonwealth, you find that from India, the National Program on Technology Enhanced Learning, this rather awkward name, NPTEL, is a very big player in this area. And NCERT is a big player. And even our own Tamil Nadu Textbooks Corporation, you don't easily expect that they would have this vision. They've moved in with 200 full textbooks, full text. And this is the big attraction for the Western world, you know, open textbooks, which are free to download, fairly good quality. And these are available. OpenStax is a library built cooperatively by many people. The authors don't get any honorarium. They simply make their stuff available. At least some are considered to be extraordinarily good, and most are considered to be really good. And the province of British Columbia has given enough resources to publish 40 textbooks of their own, I mean, at very considerable risk to their reputation among commercial publishers. But NPTEL is really big. As I said, you know, if you look at the quality of stuff there is very high. And in fact, I remember seeing a lecture on quantum mechanics. You normally don't take, so how many of you have heard a lecture in quantum mechanics? Not many. And the lecture of Balakrishnan on quantum mechanics has 500,000 views. Because many people say that the Indian style of teaching QMAC, as we call it, is superior. I mean, it's much easier to understand. It's a chalk and talk, as you see here in the screen. But many, many people from all over the world are flocking to that. But India has also gone ahead and published a lot of courses, digital content, in the area of agricultural sciences. As you can see from this slide provided to me by Dr. P.S. Pandey from ICAR, they published the equivalent of 15,820 hours equivalent of instruction. Every single undergraduate course in India is covered in English, 425 of them, every area, agriculture, engineering, home science, dairy tech, fisheries, etc. And peer review and created by teams. And this beautiful resource, believe me, is not available from the land-grant college system of United States, on which bulk of India's agricultural education and research is modeled. They are falling behind, and India could be a leader. India is already a leader. Only tragedy is the Indian Council of Agricultural Research, which is very good at producing this volume, has not developed a very good publishing strategy. So they are in a particular site, e-courses that IASRA, I believe it could be much better. The site is not as good as it could be. China, Jinping Ke, is a very national top-level course. It's a huge program with 11,000 full courses. And if you can read here, they're committed to their ideology too, as you can see somewhere on the left. Marxist theory and ideas, like Marxist class and ideological and moral courses. There are 300 of them. So clearly China is still committed to Marxism, looks like. Out of 11,000, they're putting out 300 courses on Marxism. These 11,000 cover everything. They have 568 courses in agriculture. So now, these are all for the connected people. And what do we do for the unconnected people? There are lots of people who are not connected. In fact, I've brought a small device where my colleagues and I have been working on this idea of creating a micro server for rural areas with no power, no connectivity. You can see this device here, which is called Aptus. I wanted to give a name appropriate for us country yokels, but apparently it's a Latin name too, so somebody called it Aptus. And you can see here the minister in Vanuatu, which is one of the poorest countries in the world, or the poorest country in the Pacific and one of the poorest in the world, which was devastated by cyclone. They are receiving Aptus because it contains 3,000 videos from Khan Academy, 100,000 articles from Wikipedia in English, and map resources and a complete school information system, and Moodle, which is a learning management system, all built into this with its own power source. So you can just carry it, we call it classroom without walls. You could run a class under the tree, literally, if your students have access to tablets or phones. That takes me to another dimension. You know, in the Western world, we spoke about the cost of books, and the cost of higher education in general is rising. And if you see this slightly outdated one, it's 2012 from The Economist. The college tuition fees have risen by a factor of 14 over a period of less than 35 years. So it's a huge increase. And late management guru Peter Drucker, back in 2000, pointed out that both health costs and higher education costs in the Western world were spiraling out of control. And he said that today both are necessary for anyone, whether you're a working class individual or a rich individual, you need both this for you to function in this society. And he pointed out that this could prove to be highly detrimental in the long run. And it is, you know, high college tuition fee has become a very big consideration. If you ever have time, watch this wonderful video on PBS Frontline, which explains what privatization has done to higher education in the United States, how rock musicians who failed to find a local market have bought colleges and are selling degrees and pushing students deep into debt. And the student debts have increased to full $1.1 trillion. And government has made it clear that this is not a viable loan. I mean, anyone who ever availed it must pay, even under bankrupted condition, even if you're in a jail, you must arrange to pay. I mean, they make it very clear. So in that, what do you find? I mean, this Time magazine says that 36% of college graduates did not show any significant cognitive gains. This is after losing money to the extent of $1 trillion. You have a degree that's unworkable. Right? And half the employers say they're unemployable too. So this is the crisis in higher education in countries in North America. On the other hand, online enrollment has been increased, a parallel one. Online enrollment as a percentage of total enrollment is steadily going up. That is the power of internet. I mean, you know, internet is advanced. The costs are not going down, but people have shifted more and more to a new medium. And it's happening in Asia too. You know, Asia has had the highest growth, like Vietnam. Has had registered huge growth in the way they ship to online courses. Malaysia shows a similar one. So it's not that poor countries can't do it, they can. Rich countries are also doing it, and this one, that poorer countries are also doing it. It is in this context that I must talk about the second development, the massive open online course. And this slide I borrowed, I mean, the diagram is available in the Wikipedia, but the statement below, where MOOC, where every letter is negotiable, is a contribution by Sir John Denier, former colleague. And massive open online course can have 200,000 students per single course. That's the record. That when Anant Agarwal at MIT offered a course on circuits at level 6, meaning it's a graduate course, 200,000 people registered, and the person who came out as the highest ranker was a person from Mongolia, I mean, not from United States. So, and that person, it turned out, did not have a basic degree. So, in other words, massive open online courses opened a totally new dimension of an expert talking to a student. I mean, so totally new ways. The open can be interpreted in various ways, but in most courses, open means you join without any particular background check. Like you could do a lecture on, you could do a course on quantum mechanics without having done a course on elementary mathematics. I mean, that's also possible. It's online, of course, and it's a course because it does lead to some kind of statement of participation, in some cases to formal certificates. It's still an open, negotiable one. The MOOC has been in the media. New York Times celebrated it in 2012. They call it the year of the MOOC. And The Economist has been writing frequently, what they called it once, the attack of the MOOCs. And they predicted a creative destruction of higher education. I mean, we're not saying that higher education should be destroyed. All we are saying is that the pressures are mounting enormously on a system that creates endless debts for a large number of people. So there are big brands here. I won't go into them. Coursera operates from Stanford. I mean, it's a company out of Stanford. EDX is a company out of MIT. Future Learn is United Kingdom. That's the only one. And I believe India is about to launch its own platform or program called Swayam very soon. That's what I heard while talking to officials in the Ministry of HRD. Now, all these MOOC, look at the youth unemployment here. Let's look at the youth unemployment and try to link it to MOOC. They're reaching all kinds of people, no doubt. This should be 2009. I mean, you know, what it shows is that between 2009 and 2014, there is noticeable increase in unemployment world over. And China is in, as you can see, is in deep red. There's lots of people facing unemployment there. As does India is very close. I mean, India is not very far behind. And the country where I'm currently living, Canada is also facing unemployment, that I know very well. And unemployment is considered to be, by 2019, it's going to be much worse. That's what they're saying. It's going to be much worse for most countries than we are willing to admit. And, you know, Professor wrote back in 1993 that youth with education but with no opportunities will contribute to social strife. So let's keep that in mind here. When you look at tertiary education, because people believe in educating their way out of unemployment, it's a very strong belief to this minute in many countries. You go through higher end of formal education, people believe they can find employment. And you find that the United States is a strong believer. 94% of people in the college-going age are actually in a college. And whereas India, it's 25%. I mean, India is a very large country, of course. In the United Kingdom, it's 62%. But look at Seychelles with a population of 200,000. There's only 1% who are, I mean, you know, that's a very, very stark contrast. In other words, the poorer countries probably don't have the aspiration or don't have the wherewithal to realize it, but they do not, they are not still not able to find a way to relate employment and education yet. But it's becoming increasingly clear that some way must be found. Here is where, you know, I found this interesting slogan, skills, scale and speed. I mean, you must build up skills very, very fast because, and youth unemployment is becoming a big threat, and you must do it on a scale because you can see the speed with which unemployment is spreading. And you must also do it with sufficient speed, not only on scale, but you must do it with a sense of urgency. And this is attributed to Mr. Narendra Modi back in 2012 when he was Chief Minister of Gujarat. I found that he was talking about it in a slide. And he has talked about it once more in the meeting when India and other countries came together to form the BRICS Bank. Again, he said, you know, this is my aim. I mean, if we don't do these three S's, we are finished. And I'll later add a E to that. I'll tell you why. So we need, therefore, MOOCs have the advantages. They can provide scale, they can provide the reach, and they can be very fast to roll out. I mean, people can roll out a MOOC in less than 4 weeks, and whereas a typical college course takes 2 years to formulate, and you can imagine it takes one term to deliver. So that's what The way Coursera and others are doing it, again, will never address the paradigm that Professor Swaminathan created. That's why we need something called MOOC for development. The focus should be on topics related to sustainable development, and it should be very targeted capacity building, not a broadcast mode. I mean, that's where, again, the value addition step will come in. And we must appreciate that a lot of users will be very limited in terms of their experience in online learning and behavior. We'll later give some examples. And that a lot of mentoring and tutoring would be required. When Professor Anant Agarwal runs a course from MIT, he has two teaching assistants. That's it. But he will address 200,000. If you are stuck, well, you are stuck. I mean, Anant Agarwal is not going to help you. Or his teaching assistants won't receive your phone calls or answer your emails. You are stuck. Whereas here, we need a lot more mentoring. And we must be prepared to provide a lot of offline support, because with due respect, I do find that in most parts of our country, internet access, especially for videos, is still not as good as it could be. And in the Commonwealth of Learning, we tied up in a partnership with the Indian Institute of Technology in Kanpur, and we ran a very successful MOOC on mobiles for development. It attracted people from over 100 countries, and 85% of them were active. And we also then, there was a demand for academic community, especially from India, said, tell us how to run a MOOC. We want to run a MOOC ourselves. We ran a MOOC on MOOC, again, a very successful one with 112 countries, bulk coming from India, but very active participation. Mauritius, a small country, had very good participation. Some of their videos they produced as part of the practical exercise, really outstanding. And in fact, IIT created a separate certification system for these MOOCs. So we were not stopping with this. We were going into MOOCs for agriculture. Because, as I said, the land-grant college system is falling behind when it comes to online matters. Their websites are not only poor, they're also falling behind in terms of offering online courses. And unfortunately, the state agriculture university system in India is heavily patterned after the land-grant colleges. So they're taking no effort either. So with the help of the Indian Institute of Technology, we have created a small consortium, which receives very small funding from the NPTEL in India. And we did run a couple of courses, and there are more courses coming starting from December. And our understanding was that agriculture students were even more disadvantaged. Their behavior in online was exceptionally revealing. These are people with very high level of capability and background. And it looks like, you know, they're good with Facebook and WhatsApp on social matters. But when you ask them to do the same thing on educational matters, they're falling behind. They would rather like a phone call or, you know, the teacher showing up sometimes mysteriously in your home or something. I mean, you know, so we realize that there's a considerable lag between agricultural students and IT students. For example, when NPTEL announced the first MOOC, they had to suspend because 55,000 students signed up. They never planned for more than 10,000, and they did not have the capacity. Whereas in agriculture, we planned for 1,000, there were 3,000, but we expected more. Anyway, so we built a number of subsidiary technologies. This is one. I mean, if you're a technologist, you'll understand that you can use the websites to communicate directly to mobile phones on voice. And it's a very, very, very easy software. It was entirely built by a team of bumbling engineers at the Indian Institute of Technology in Kanpur. None of them would have got in as a student in an IIT, which is why they were able to do first-class work. They built a really robust system. And this has been serving people, 30,000 people, over a period of 4 years. It's tested very well. And this is, as you can see, you can connect to the nearest district. I mean, you can call a number, but it will connect you to the nearest district for contact, coaching, etc. And this brilliant technology was built in India. It's available in India. It's behind. And it's also chronicled in this book edited by Muhammad Ali. That was used to create a program called MOOC for Malis. I mean, the types that you see here, I mean, who really work in the field. And their own knowledge base was poor, we found. And therefore, we ran a MOOC for Malis. But we limited the registration to 1,000, only because of the cost of telephones. And these people used only basic cell phones to receive a lesson, 30 seconds, 35 seconds to 1 minute audio clips. And they would go crop by crop. They could choose to receive them at their own time. So it was never bothering them when they were at work. And out of that, nearly 263 graduated. And the IIT Kanpur awarded. The students we didn't realize were also posing as Malis and joining and taking them. Here is one student. And we then built a complete platform for this. It's called MOOCIT, and it's architecturally very simple. It addresses the biggest challenge of scalability. Because as you all know, if you have one computer and you connect five people to that, it's one thing. When you connect 50,000 people to that, the computer can collapse. And scalability, therefore, is a big engineering challenge. India has solved it in many ways. And here is one more solution from, again, from the same group of engineers from IIT Kanpur. And it looks very simple and very easy to use on desktop. It's also fully compatible on mobile. Today, MOOCIT is already, it was evolved in India. The Commonwealth of Learning deployed it on a couple of MOOCs. Now it's used in Fiji. It's going to be used in Nigeria. It's ready for use in the School of Tropical Medicine and Health in London. And it will soon be used in a few more countries. So it's spreading because it's a very good work that India has done in this regard. And much of this is covered in a policy brief that we published. Now, coming to this, Professor's vision of virtual academy on the online and flexible learning can go together. And I call it higher education plus. In the Western world, the purpose of this policy brief was MOOCs are seen primarily as a higher education phenomenon. We are saying that it can be higher education plus. MALIS could also be involved in it. And virtual academy MOOCs concept can really create the higher education plus. You could award what we call, or many people call, micro or nano degrees. So don't wait for a 3-year full-time course to receive one degree. You can follow a cafeteria approach. Specific skills can be recognized in terms of specific degrees. You call them nano degrees or micro degrees. In fact, people like Dr. Martin Beam, who created Future Learn in UK, now currently president of the Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology, a very eminent IT specialist as well as an academician, thinks that this is really the way to go. And you can create framework to recognize these kind of degrees. You know, recognizing a whole degree is bound with many vested interests, and governments don't want to enter that area. Whereas micro nano degrees are much easier. And you can create, with the help of MOOCIT as well as with the cell phone technologies that IIT and others have built, you can also localize them by creating local contact centers. That was what was done in Mali's course, where you called a number and the local man was willing to guide you and mentor you. So skill, speed, and scale is achievable. But what is missing currently is the ethics dimension. So I think that should be there. In fact, I say this with some trepidation because following the revelation of Edward Snowden, we all know that what unethical IT could do, and it's doing. I mean, you know, it looks like there's no escape. The scale and extent of compromise that governments have created in online systems is so unimaginably deep that we probably will never escape that. Many people are, and I'm sad to say only one thing, that the professional societies which built the internet never have criticized the secret codes and other measures that led to all these practices. Many governments are involved, it's not just one government. That's why I say ethics is very, very important. Lastly, innovations are also important, but let's look at this slide for just 1 minute. I mean, it's a very complex slide, but look at the diagram D at the lower part. And what it shows is this is a brilliant analysis by 3 workers from Switzerland. What they did was they did an analysis of who we all know, the top 20%, that's a lot of concentration of wealth in the world. But what we miss is that the concentration is heavily interconnected. In other words, these people analyzed 30,000 global companies in terms of their wealth and who actually controls that wealth. And some of them, whom we call companies, it turns out that they're not registered as companies in their own country domains. So they still went through the bookwork and analyzed it. And what they say is 147 global corporations control 50% of the wealth, and of them, many of them, most of them, are controlled by no more than these 11 groups which are listed here, whose names are listed here, whose are heavily interconnected through joint boards or individuals being represented, participating in more than one board, etc. And what it shows is that a small group of people can control what innovation is. For example, Uber. Many of you are hearing of Uber. You have Ola in India, you have Uber. And the much fanfare that we see in London Economist about Uber is something I don't understand. There's no technology there. But it's clear that if the group of people here decide that that should be promoted, it can happen. They can also suppress an innovation. So in IT, you have the problem of ethics. On the other hand, you have this enormous concentration of control. So when you innovate, you know, don't worry about startups. You don't want to remain a startup. You want to blow big. Keep in mind that these guys can either allow you or can destroy you. Coming back to SDGs, I'm really glad that this time the SDGs recognize inequality as a major problem. Professor spoke about it in 1993. The MDGs completely ignored that, never spoke about it. The Goal 10 really speaks about it. It also talks about equity and access to education because of the huge debt mass that is piling and the wrong models that are being spread all over. So we are really glad that the SDGs are going to discuss that. I hope our political leaders and senior officials will consensually agree to reaching these goals. And more important for me is for the first time in a big gathering like this, the word people is mentioned, planet is mentioned, along with peace, partnership, prosperity. These five P's have never been discussed before. So now I'm coming to the close of this talk. You know, Madras used to be Madras, and Madras was a science city. Thanks to late Dr. A.L. Mudaliar, late Professor G.N. Ramachandran moved to Madras, then Madras in 1952. And in 1955, he proposed a unique model of collagen. I mean, you know, it's scientifically a big breakthrough, and which was hotly contested, eventually agreed. But that led to enormous international recognition for Madras. I mean, after Srinivasa Ramanujan, Subramaniam Chandrasekhar, or Dr. C.V. Raman, you would find that this recognition as a science city to Madras came through the work of late Professor G.N. Ramachandran. But it's time to recognize Madras now as the Center of Science for Sustainable Development, thanks to the work that Professor Swaminathan has inspired all of us to do, and thanks to the work that he's continuing to guide and inspire. So the Sambhita Shergill painting, and Professor always put people at the center of science and development, and so I'm very, very happy to be here. Thank you, Professor, for the opportunity.
I think everyone will agree that this is the most interesting and also beautifully delivered lecture. Thank you, Balaji, for this very fine, instructive, insightful, and at the end of it, encouraging, but also truth-telling where it needed to be told lecture. And we find that in some of these areas, while we are lagging behind, India is lagging behind in the in internet penetration into the population, lagging behind, shamefully I should say, there are areas where we have done extremely well, it appears, from this lecture in the area of open educational resources and also massive open online courses and so forth. But it's a little disappointing that students who study the agricultural science in agricultural universities seem to be lagging behind from at least in critical areas. This is a great passion for Professor Swaminathan in the past. He always emphasized the need to build capability and to raise the quality there, and perhaps the time has come to proclaim this as a problem and to respond to it constructively. I think at the end of this, there was a lot of very encouraging messages that came through about what has been done, and but what more important, what needs to be done. If you adopt the right methods, put the emphasis on science, and I think a special feature of Balaji's lecture was the way he connected various things together. And as for the mode of presentation, I really want to call attention to it, because I've sat through any number of slide presentation where the presenter simply reads what everyone can see there, provided you haven't crammed too much into a slide. But here was an example. Since we are talking about communication also here, those interested in it, please note how the lecture was quite not independent of the slide presentation, but added a lot of value to it. It was really a lecture which was supported by a slide presentation, although there are plenty of slides. Please note that. In the Hindu, whenever somebody made a presentation like simply reading it, I used to stop them, and we virtually banned it. But even today, it continues merrily in every place. So I think that's an area, a specialized area to be noted. And he's also called attention to major social problems, above all the question of mass deprivation and also youth unemployment, which is clearly getting worse. I referred to the problems in Europe, the refugee crisis and so on, where also something can be done, but mainly by way of relief rather than any major correction. MOOCs, I've read some of the literature, and there seems to be, this may be a question for Balaji to start it, and then please feel free to ask him. You have at least 15, 20 minutes after this, or even longer if he's willing to stay. I need to leave soon after 4, but perhaps Professor Swaminathan can take over. On this business of open licensing of content on MOOCs, the trend now is to do closed licensing, isn't it? You call attention to it, and I hope India goes the right way. This is a major issue where I think conflicts of interests are involved, and while access will be to all students, free access, the ability to build on these courses, I think some of the concerns may be legitimate. You don't want all kinds of adulteration of your content, especially in science. So there is an issue there, but as long as the rules of the game are clear and safeguards are in place, one would always favor open licensing, and he can explain to that. But I've read some assessments of MOOC where they said they promised much, didn't deliver enough, and now they seem to be in retreat, which seems to be a rather unkind characterization. There's a quote I read on that. But what would you say about it? But above all, thank you for a splendid lecture, where I think it'll make us think, and the way without, there's no formality in connecting it with the vision and practice of Professor Swaminathan and the institutions he has built. And one of the heartening things that come out is, I think his conviction has been proved right, that people don't need to be highly educated. That happened during the Green Revolution, when there were all kinds of forecasts, pessimistic forecasts, all obstacles. But all those obstacles just crumbled when something could be scientifically proven, could be testable even immediately, and the communication systems were available, the extension workers and so on. And also the demonstrations, how they worked. The same thing could happen, I think, in this area where the audience is much bigger. So I think that the way he connected it with the work of this foundation makes us proud, and makes me in particular proud to be a trustee of this foundation, because we often raise the question, how relevant is this work today, against all that needs to be done, or do you really make a difference and so on. But I think this re-emphasizes and re-establishes the validity, the relevance, and the tremendous value to science and society that Professor Swaminathan's great leadership, and also his direct involvement, the resources he has put into this, his altruistic attitude have made. I'm not saying it, in fact it's embarrassing to say it when he's there, yeah, right before us. But I think the way he connected it is entirely persuasive. So I made a rather long, I won't speak anymore, but please, who's going to ask the next question?
Whichever is comfortable. I can speak from here. Is it okay if I spoke from here? Thank you. Thank you very much for your kind words. About the MOOC, Daphne Koller, who's the founder of Coursera, she and I participated in a panel a few weeks back. And she was saying that, look, back in 2012, we were told to dismantle the higher education system. They said that we must dismantle the higher education system. And now we are being told that we are actually dismantling it, and therefore we are being condemned. So I don't know how to take it. That's what she said. My own understanding is the higher MOOC as something contributing only to higher education is a debate that is safely left to the North American universities, because there are vested interests. And the faculty feels very threatened by the rise of MOOCs. And therefore they do feel, especially the humanities, arts, English teachers, they feel that they will be done away in no time, because MOOCs will allow everyone to flood into skill and technology courses. Therefore they fear. And therefore there's a lot of resistance, etc., to that. And university presidents were warm, and now they're not, no longer warm. But what we found is, this is like cable television. It was invented in the United States for a particular purpose. But India found a great opportunity in 1990s. Long before telephone lines reached villages, cable lines reached them. The same way we believe we can repurpose MOOC completely because it's providing a brand new medium. The scalability issues solved, the media streaming issues solved, the analytics issues solved. These were all disparate technologies, and Coursera, edX have brought them together. We simply take them and redeploy them in a totally different context in a country like India. Therefore, higher education debate, we don't participate only because we know that there are vested interests on both sides. But nano degree, micro degree is a big thing. That's one reason why the universities don't talk about it, because they know that that can undermine them completely. The 94% gross enrollment ratio could fall in just about 5 years' time because people would move more towards micro degrees. Thank you.
Is India's gross enrollment ratio?
This is the figure that Government of India provides. This is what Government of India has provided to World Bank. It does look, I mean, coming from India, for a, I think it's a very high figure. We also know that...
Please explain what gross enrollment ratio is.
It's a gross enrollment ratio, for those not familiar with it, is the number of people, college-going age in a country, let's say it's 100. If the number of people who are actually in a college is the gross enrollment ratio. So, for example, India has 25 means. There are people in the college-going age, which is broadly defined as between 16 to 29. And if in this, they, according to the statistics, 25% of all those in that age group are inside a college. Now, we know that this would include open university enrollment. Open universities in India, with due respect, have problem of controlling the numbers because there are double, triple, multiple counts. For example, if I registered in a BCom course and a BA course, I count as two students. And there are many who are inactive, meaning people who join as a student only because it enables them to buy a bus pass at a concessional rate. And there are many open university students who are doing that in Delhi. So there are many such, like, you know, apart, we're not sure if it could be high, but it does look like a very high number.
I'm Professor Nagarajan, formerly Department of Adult and Continuing Education, University of Madras. The statistics says that gross enrollment ratio as on today is 17% at the national level. In Tamil Nadu, it is 19%. 19.
Oh, I see. So this is this figure reaching World Bank is also an official figure. So I don't know how World Bank is computing that.
No, that they have put what is called, when if you want to have your threshold is 25% for India to become only advanced country.
Okay.
So they have put it as a threshold.
Okay.
But what really happens is the annually every time when they are taking the detail, current rate Tamil Nadu is at a higher level.
Highest.
By the way, I want to raise only one issue here. When we talk about sustainable development here, it's a communication. The communication must be bi-directional. When bi-directional is there, it is one-to-many or one-to-one. When it is there, what happens? The lecturer can deliver, but the participants cannot come and participate. If they participate, what happens is some technical problem is there. This problem is a very important problem for taking any type of learning to the rural area. This is what we found.
Right. Thank you. Thank you, sir. Can I just briefly answer? The second part of, thanks for mentioning the 19% in Tamil Nadu. We will bring it also to the notice. Important point. Which is one way. For example, if you look at the website of various newspapers and magazines in the Hindu group, they're interactive because you can comment on every issue. And there is an probably an editor who oversees these comments and filters them, but it's possible. The same way, the MOOC's biggest strength is its social space. So hundreds and hundreds of people are talking in the social space. So the lecturer's job is to essentially mentor them and facilitate them. And sometimes you find that one active student can also guide other students. It's not the same as one ignorant person teaching other ignorant people. But they often, you find that you enter the social forum, you find that very insightful discussions are taking place. So, and that it happens when 200,000 people are present is something, a very difficult challenge for the lecturer to manage, but today they're evolving systems to do that more and more. So it's a big thing. The social space is big. And so MOOC is really more social learning than active learning in the way we understood it in a classroom setting.
I'm Manjula, working in the Swaminathan Research Foundation. I just have a couple of clarificatory questions. These kind of nano degrees or micro degrees, as you call it, which is given as an online certificate, how competent are they in the job market? What is the level of acceptance by the job providers for this kind of degrees is one thing. And second is, how do you see this method, pedagogic method? Do you find this complementing the other kind of pedagogic methods, or you find like 20 years down the line, this will just substitute all other methods? Just your take on this.
First question, micro degrees are already heavily recognized in the corporate sector. For example, I know one character who did 5 courses in data science in Coursera and got a micro degree. That individual got an immediate job in Infosys, whereas they would not call him for any interview because of is very poor quality B.Tech in computer science. So even in India, many of these degrees are gaining recognition. The other is about pedagogy. Well, online, there is an online pedagogy. But compared to that in MOOC, the difference is that this is also connected to internet. So when it is connected via online, need not always be internet connected. And online pedagogy is a very well established thing thanks to the work of UK Open University. But when you mix internet with it, a totally new dimension gets added. So it's evolving, and we don't know where it would take us, whether it will substitute, replace anything. But the fact is, world lives with competing pedagogies all the time. You know, classroom is not the only one. We are also learning from various places, like you may be learning while a lecture like this is in progress. The competing pedagogies, complementary pedagogies always exist. One need not become the end all.
Yes, you referred in passing to
Devendra Oza.
you already spoke in passing about skill generation. I think that since it is in the right hands now, I think Mr. Ramdurai is in overall charge of the whole situation. And I still call it a work in progress. Am I right?
Absolutely.
If it's a work in progress, I have a feeling that there is a lot of scope at micro level, not at the level of India and whole states and so on, at the micro level, like a district or a taluk, or some kind of pioneering spirit. Pioneering spirit and flexibility in this program. If these two, pioneering spirit and flexibility, are introduced at micro level in this, I think it should be very rewarding. Would you broadly agree?
NSDC, National Skills CI, Agricultural Skills Corporation. They've done a fantastic job. Intellectually, I thought that it could not be more complete. India is always good. I mean, in developing some of these approaches, good. very, very good at things like this. But as you rightly said, how do you create skills at the micro? For example, I remember the Prime Minister of India referring to something in a speech saying that I cannot find a good cook even when I want it, right? Because the skills are totally lacking. So how do you do this? Who are excellent cooks, who make excellent pastries or dosas, etc. Now at that level, if you see the NSDC, their vision is definitely leading in that direction. But what you find is the allied institutions, the university system, is paying very little attention. With due respect, I was in an IIT. When I spoke to one of the very senior officials there, he made a remark that got me thinking that he's probably dismissive of the entire skills development exercise. Because he said, we have other things to do. What is the skill? Screwdrivers, this, that, extra. There are others to do. On the other hand, the IIT in Kanpur is running a course to train 3,000 people in basic machining, because Kanpur is a center of defense production industry. And it's seriously short of skilled labor. And so the IIT stepped in. They said that they would create, within 6 months, reasonably trained people for. So people are doing in both. They're responding to a local need, and they're responding to a national need. The problem is the wherewithal at the institutional level seems to be missing. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you so much. It was a very well conducted. MOOC, of course, which is a future pathway for reaching out sustainable development, and we are very happy that we have initiated this MOOC platform this year. We are working on to take it forward across the nation. So I'm glad that we are on track. And since we have taken up that, I have one critical question where you talked about the learning behavior, where how effective, you know, what are the critical areas we need to look into to upkeep the learning behavior while we are taking these students on board. That is one. The second one, of course, the NSDC has come out with lots of critical skill lists, and they are also directed towards sustainable development. And I'm just connecting that to our virtual fellows. Wherein we can also get into that, because in context of poor connectivity in some of the areas, still we are yet to work on SWAN network. There are progress happening across the. Yeah, in that sense, what is the probability to reach these virtual community?
Thank you, Nancy. About the question on NSDC and specific skills, personally, you know, not very, because my information primarily is gathered from the web and occasional conversations. So I do not know the specifics, but my impression is there is still not much of an understanding of how to connect unconnected people and create virtual community. That's where I propose the idea of using the cell phone technology. You can create audio-based social networking. It's quite possible. And we could probably do some experiments and trials on them. About your other question, how to sustain learning interest, you know, one of my friends gave me an example that, in casinos in Nevada, state of United States, you know, there are casinos, they thrive on them. They want people to be gambling all the time. But they say around 1 o'clock in the night, there is a saturation. People don't want to gamble, their brains are fagged. So at that time, through the air conditioning duct, they inject oxygen into the whole place. So their theory is that when there is more oxygen, your brains are more active, so you will gamble more. The same way we call it in MOOC, the injecting the oxygen. You play more. You gamble more. The winner is always the owner of the casino. So the idea here is we say the same thing in MOOC. I mean, you know, when you find that the activity is falling, step in and inject some oxygen by creating a new activity, ask a question, ask them to do an activity. There are many methods. But people are aware that in a 6-week MOOC, after the second week, there is a down, and then they step in and inject the oxygen. So you have to plan it well in time. Thank you.
Since there are no more questions, I request for please.
I'm sorry, I may take a bit of time to articulate the question because I've been thinking about it since about halfway through your talk. So if I have the time, I'll ask. Otherwise, I'll talk to him after the lecture. From your description, though you did not say so explicitly, it seemed to me that you are basically talking about learning in terms only of cognitive learning. Are you also addressing affective learning and what do you call it, physiomotor skills in the same way? Because when you talk about skill development, there are many kinds of skills, and there are also motor skills, which play a very important component in human life. And affective learning is equally important. So without the nurturing and development of all those dimensions, I would not call it learning. So is your definition of learning purely cognitive? Because talking about different elements by which the cognitive domain can be more easily spread out and reach to a larger number of people. So is it only numbers game? We're dealing with millions of people, that's good learning. What we do about other dimensions of learning, or those don't come into the picture? Even skills are of many types. There are also mental skills. I remember when I first went to the Philippines, that was in the 80s, I was stunned when I went to the market to find that the market women, all of whom had education at least up to fifth grade, because they follow American system, all of them had education up to fifth grade, and as soon as I finished buying, and I would say, do mental arithmetic, as we are trained to do at least in our generation, and would come up with the total, and I'd be restlessly waiting, and the woman would take out her little pocket calculator. And then after a long while, she would tell me the number. Now, I'm used to haggling with market women in India who are supposed to be completely illiterate and are not supposed to be. They've never been to school, they can't read and write. But within seconds, they would have totaled up and told me. And then they'll be patiently waiting for me with my school-educated mind to do the total. So I think if the computer is designed on the human brain, then obviously it has to follow that method. Now, these market women knew it by something called folk mathematics, about which my friend L.S. Saraswati is an expert, so I won't go into it. But I think there are other dimensions of the mind which are involved, and I'm sure those dimensions can also be, or I'm not so sure, but perhaps those dimensions can also be recaptured by computers. My earlier question was also about non-cognitive learnings and how you deal with those in this kind of system. And this question is on a related thing of how we deal with things like different systems of learning, like folk mathematics, as opposed to Euclidean mathematics or Greek mathematics or Arabic mathematics or so and so forth. How do you deal with all these learning systems, or do we deny legitimacy to all of the other systems and only accept one system of learning as legitimate?
Would you like to answer?
First, briefly, then we can take some offline. You know, this in today's world, people are looking at scalability as a big thing. And secondly, scalability now is in the hands of engineers, and therefore engineers have, I would say, a slightly primitive understanding of pedagogy and learning. So they proceed in a direction that they know well. But what emerges, for example, I did personally a course from University of Tasmania, MOOC on dementia. And that was delivered, that I rated as the best MOOC ever in the last few years. There are over 4,000 MOOCs, but in a discussion, I rated it and many others rated it as the best, because it was two nurses were simply in a conversation. That's how the whole course was delivered. So people are inventing new techniques in the middle of all this because they use media in an extensive way.
So, right.
And skills are coming, skills are coming. For example, there is a skill course in Canada which is meant for automotive, mechanics, car mechanics as we would call them. At some level, some of these skills can be completely be transferred via video. And you can practice and then report back. I mean, if you have the basic equipment, you can practice and report back. So they connect these two equipment. And so these are coming. I'm still not sure if a pilot was trained like this, if I would fly at 777, that such a pilot is flying. But they're coming. It's a bit far off. Skills development is a big thing, and people are already addressing ways. The haptics are in, you can remotely operate a device from sitting here from your computer or smartphone. You can run a lathe that is located far away and see the results for yourself. These are still coming, but affective and other parts, the bias comes from the fact that a lot of online learning is essentially oriented towards cognition development. That's the inherent bias in this. And engineers are running it, who are like the way they ruined libraries. This is how they will proceed as well. They invented Google and finished all libraries. And they are proceeding in the direction of cognitive learning. But I think some good will come out of it. Thank you.
I request Professor to give his concluding remarks.
Just 1 minute only. I won't take.
No.
I think I just want to, particularly most of the people here would not know the origin of this program. Therefore, we are grateful to Dr. Balaji for having traced the growth of the use of ICT our institution onwards when we had that interdisciplinary dialogue titled Reaching the Unreached. Role of ICT, that was the title, and it's published by Macmillan Company. From that time onwards, but really I don't want to recapitulate what he has said. He has covered from 1992 to 2015 in a beautiful way, partly local, partly global, our own institution's contribution, and at the same time what is happening in the world of education. I am very happy that you emphasize the need for skills and for the young employment, unemployment and youth. Mr. Ram knows only too well. I think one of the triggers for the growing demand for reservation is the unemployment problem, the unemployment of youth problem, and this will grow in our country unless we address it. But the qualities of Dr. Balaji, which we should all emulate, is that he converts every difficulty into an opportunity. When we started this program, in the villages, some people said, there will be no electricity, electricity will not be there. Then he brought a solar. Some people said the telephone line won't work. We were going there. And mobile telephony he never accepted that there is a problem. If there is a problem, there is a solution. That was his main philosophy. And I think it's a very important one in life, particularly when we work with rural people and so on. No difficulty. In fact, we were very convinced that this bridging the digital divide is going to be a very important contribution to bridging the gender divide. And that has also happened if you look at our academy and so on. So Dr. Balaji's contributions in the early years in developing a model for sustainable model in rural India is remarkable, I must say, because many people suggested to us that unless you have a commercial model, you charge for everything like a post office, you will not be able to survive. Some people, so the commercial model, the cooperative model, but we chose the community model. And the community model has become the most sustainable today. So I just want to mention that Dr. Balaji's not only his professional skill, but his commitment to taking the technology to the people is very important. Unfortunately, in our country, education, for example, the Indira Gandhi National Open University, IGNU is one of the largest universities, distance education universities in the world. We got them start what is called the community colleges with the help of Dr. Lata Pillai. They, the one at Pumpuhar, catered to tribal, fisherwomen and fisher girls. My own dream was in the community colleges, those who have come from very low rank should do their PhD and so on. But the community colleges were closed suddenly. And we have to develop institutional devices by which we can take the technology to the people. The IGNO and the community colleges, which can be established Koraput everywhere, is a wonderful method of converting your own dream into reality, using modern technology, reaching the unreached. So I am glad that Dr. Balaji today gave a very comprehensive look at the whole problem and then related it to the emerging sustainable development goals, which are starting from this year. UN MDGs are ending, and the UN sustainable development goals are starting. We have built in this institution a sustainable model for the utilization of ITC for development. And I think there can be many models, but the one which I see from the last 20 years is economically sustainable, it is socially sustainable, it is also from the point of view of gender equity, it's also sustainable. And you have sown the seeds of it, and thank you very much, Dr. Balaji, for coming after many years. And I hope this is a Millennium Lecture. I do hope.